Continuation of page 15, chapter 5. God has anointed you king. 1 Samuel 9:15-16. And the Lord had told Samuel in his ear a day before Saul came, saying, "Tomorrow about this time I will send you a man out of the land of Benjamin, and you shall anoint him to be captain, leader over my people Israel, so that he may save my people out of the hand of the Philistines. For I have looked on my people because their cry has come to me." When we came to Christ, we thought it was only about finding our donkeys. But God was looking for a king or a queen to anoint him or her captain or leader over his people. God wants to save, deliver, heal, and prosper his people through his anointed king or anointed queen. God looked on his people and saw how they were afflicted and oppressed by their enemy, the devil. God has great plans for every born-again Christian. Peter says to every born-again Christian, "You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for possession, so that you might speak of the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." 1 Peter 2:9. Please read the Perfect Redemption Plan of God and the application of the Perfect Redemption Plan of God so that you will know succinctly what God has done for you by the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, who you are in Christ Jesus, and what God expects you and I to do as kings and queens and priests and priestesses. 1 Samuel 9:21-25. And Saul answered and said, "Am I not a Benjamite of the smallest of the tribes of Israel? And is not my family the least of all the families of the tribe of Benjamin? Why then do you speak so to me?" And Samuel took Saul and his young men and brought them into the room and gave them a place at the head of the invited ones, about 30 persons. And Samuel said to the cook, "Bring that part which I gave you, of which I said to you, set it beside you." And the cook took up the shoulder and that on it and set it before Saul. And Samuel said, "Behold, that which is reserved, set it before you and eat, for until this set time it has been kept for you, since I said I have invited the people." And Saul ate with Samuel that day. And they came down from the high place into the city, and he spoke with Saul on the top of the house. Some Christians are like Saul. They have an inferiority complex and low self-esteem. When we read Judges 20, Benjamin fought against the 11 other tribes of Israel, and they were defeated. Only 600 men of Benjamin were left alive. That is why, even though Saul saw that the Benjamites were the smallest tribe of Israel, and on top of that his family were the least of all the families of the Benjamites, we must not look at things after the flesh. People who will follow you do not have to be of the same family or tribe or country or skin color or mother tongue as you. The leadership of God is a spiritual leadership. If you decide to do things according to the written word of God, God will send people your way, and they will follow your leadership, not because you are one of them, but because they see Jesus in you. If you understand the perfect redemption plan of God and the application of the perfect redemption plan of God, and become a faithful doer of them, God will be faithful to establish your leadership. Isaiah prophesied, "Sing, O barren, you who did not bear, break forth into singing and cry aloud, you who did not travail with child. Because more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married wife, says the Lord. Enlarge the place of your tent, and let them stretch forth the curtains of your habitations. Spare not, lengthen thy cords, and strengthen your stakes. For you shall break forth on the right hand and on the left, and your seed shall inherit the Gentiles, and make the desolate cities to be inhabited. Fear not, for you shall not be ashamed, neither be confounded, for you shall not be put to shame, for you shall forget the shame of your youth and shall not remember the reproach of your widowhood any more. For your Maker is your husband, the Lord of hosts is his name, and your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, the God of the whole earth, shall he be called. Isaiah 54, verse 1 to 5. So Jesus tells us, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto you, You must be born again. John 3, verse 5 to 7. In that Isaiah 54, Isaiah was taking the analogy of those who are born after the flesh and those who are born after the Spirit. Like Paul will explain it in Galatians 4, God promised to make Abraham great and to multiply his descendants as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. But Sarai was barren, though she gave birth to Isaac, but Isaac was not the seed of Abraham that God was talking about, but Jesus is the seed of Abraham. Galatians 3, verse 16. So God gives birth after the Spirit, not after the flesh. His kingdom also is built in the Spirit, not in the flesh. Jesus says, It is the Spirit that quickens or makes alive. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. John 6, verse 63. So if we decide to do everything according to the written word of God, we will be building it in the Spirit. We will be giving birth to things in the Spirit. But if we do things after the flesh or not according to the written word of God, we would be building things after the flesh and it does not profit. If you decide to act on the word of God, though you do not belong to people's tribes or nationality or mother tongue or skin color, they will follow your leadership because they see Jesus in you. Since, by doing the written word of God, you are walking in the Spirit, God will pour out his Spirit upon all flesh, saved and unsaved people. Joel 2, verse 28. And God will stir up the spirit of all his people, and they will come and work in the vision the Lord has given you for his kingdom. Haggai 1, verse 14. In the book of Judges 9 and Judges 10, Abimelech, the son of Gideon, that he had with his concubine of Shechem, went to his mother's brothers and conspired with them to kill all the other sons of his father Gideon, so that he would become their king. They agreed, because he was one of them, and they did not want someone who is not one of them to be leader of Israel. They carried out their plan and killed the 70 other sons of Gideon. But at the end, they were having problems. The people of Shechem were fighting Abimelech, and Abimelech was fighting them. Some of the people said, Who is Abimelech and who is Shechem, that we should serve him? Is he not the son of Gideon, and is not Zebul his officer? Serve the men of Hamor, the father of Shechem, but why should we serve him? You see, in the eyes of the people of Shechem, though at first they were happy to have Abimelech rule over them, because he was their half-brother, but as time went on, they started to say that Abimelech was not truly of the pure blood of Shechem, for his father was not a son of Hamor, the father of Shechem. And at the end of the story, they rebelled against the leadership of Abimelech. Abimelech killed them, and they killed Abimelech. Do not waste your time building anything in the flesh. The flesh profits nothing. People will receive you today, but tomorrow they will tell you, you are not truly one of them because of one reason or another. Moses also understood that his leadership was to be done in the spirit, not in the flesh. So when the people complained against him because of his wife who was black, even his elder sister Miriam and elder brother Aaron, Moses did not marry another wife who was a pure Israelite so that people would accept his leadership. God fought for Moses and plagued Miriam with leprosy to let everybody know that this kingdom of God is not after the flesh, but after the spirit. Numbers 12, verse 1 to 16. So let us not be like Saul. He was so afraid that people would leave him that he compromised the word of God. In 1 Samuel 13, he went with his army to fight against the Philistines. He had 2,000 men with him, and his son Jonathan had 1,000 men with him. The Philistines gathered to fight with Israel, 30,000 chariots and 6,000 horsemen, and people like the sand on the seashore in multitude. And they came up and pitched in Michmash, eastward from Beth Aven. And the men of Israel saw that they were in a tight place, for the people were distressed. And the people hid themselves in caves, and in thickets, and in rocks, and in high places, and in pits. And the Hebrews went over Jordan to the land of Gad and Gilead. And Saul was still in Gilgal, and all the people followed him trembling. And he waited 7 days according to the set time with Samuel, but Samuel did not come to Gilgal. And the people were scattered from him. And Saul said, "Bring a burnt offering here to me, and peace offerings." And he offered the burnt offering. And it happened, as soon as he had made an end of offering the burnt offering, behold, Samuel came. And Saul went out to meet him and to kneel to him, and Samuel said, "What have you done?" And Saul said, "Because I saw that the people were scattered from me, and you did not come in the days appointed. And the Philistines gathered themselves at Michmash, and I said, 'The Philistines will come down now on me to Gilgal.' And I have not made supplication to Jehovah, and I forced myself and offered a burnt offering." And Samuel said to Saul, "You have done foolishly. You have not kept the commandment of Jehovah your God, which he commanded you. For now the Lord would have established your kingdom upon Israel for ever. But now your kingdom shall not stand. Jehovah has sought him a man after his own heart, and Jehovah has appointed him to be leader over his people, because you have not kept what Jehovah commanded you." 1 Samuel 13, 5-14. So why did God say to Samuel to come make the people wait at least for 7 days, and Samuel came late? God already said to Moses that when they go to battle, the officers shall speak further to the people, and they shall say, "Who is the man that is fearful and faint-hearted? Let him go and return to his house, lest his brother's heart faint as well as his heart." Deuteronomy 20, verse 8. They already spent 40 years in the wilderness because of the evil report of 10 of the 12 spies that went into the promised land. They made the heart of their brothers faint. But Saul was not bold enough to say it to the people, because he was looking at the things after the flesh. How can we, with 3,000 men, fight more than 36,000 Philistines? But God said, "One of us should chase 1,000, and two should put 10,000 to flight." Deuteronomy 32, verse 30. So since Saul was not bold enough to tell them to return to their houses, God delayed Samuel so that the people would leave by themselves. Gideon also had an inferiority complex, but when God called him to go to deliver Israel, the Lord said to Gideon, "Go in this might of yours, and you will save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have I not sent you?" So Gideon said to the Lord, "O my Lord, how can I save Israel? Indeed, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house." And the Lord said to him, "Surely I'll be with you, and you shall defeat the Midianites as one man." Judges 6, verse 14 to 16. Gideon decided to believe the report of the Lord. When we read in Judges 7, Gideon was not afraid to tell the people who were fearful to return to their houses, and also the people who could not give the glory to God, to also depart at once. Gideon was left with 300 men to fight the Midianites. But Saul did not obey the commandment of God. He acted foolishly. He offered that sacrifice to make the people stay with him. God found a man after his own heart, even David the son of Jesse, who would keep his command, and the Lord had anointed him king over Israel. David was a man after God's own heart, not because he was singing all the time, no, because he was doing what God was commanding him and not compromising with the standard of God. Jesus says, "If you love me, keep my commandments," John 14, verse 15. If a man loves me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. John 14, verse 23. Yes, God loved David because he did his best to keep his commandment. For instance, in 1 Samuel 17, when Saul and all the army was in their hideouts, David went on his own to fight Goliath and all the Philistines' army. All born-again Christians are kings and priests, or queens and priestesses, but it is up to us to make God establish our leadership. If we act like Saul, God will not establish our leadership, because we are not doing things according to his written word, but according to the flesh. But if we decide to do things according to the written word of God, God will establish us. Jesus gave us the parable of the talent in Matthew 25:14-30. One servant was given 5 talents, the other 2 talents, and the other 1 talent. The master gave it according to each one's ability. God knew they were able to handle what they were given. Some people God knew they could handle 5 talents. They worked and got 5 other talents, and the master now gave them 10. Those who had 2, some worked with their 2 talents and had 2 extra talents. So the master gave those 4 talents. But some had 1 talent and they did not work with that talent. So the master removed that talent from them and gave it to the one who already had 10. Because the master could trust him with more. The same way, God can give a person 1 talent, he works with that and he gets 1 extra, so God now gives him 2, and he works with those 2 and he has 2 extra, so God gives him 4. He works with his 4 and gets 4 extra, so God now gives him 8 talents. So God looks at the one to whom he gave 5 talents, but did not do anything with those talents. God will take away those 5 talents and give it to the one who had initially 1 talent, but has worked his way up to 8 talents. Saul had everything delivered to him on a golden platter. Physically, Saul was built up to be a warrior, so he was a 5 talents person. But David was not initially a 5 talents person. He was not a warrior, but a shepherd. He was not even of the age of being enlisted in the army. But he started by killing the bear and then the lion that came against his father's sheep. And now he came against Goliath, 1 Samuel 17. He was working his initial 1 talent, and God was watching him. David had to fight the battles of Israel before being enthroned king of Israel. He had to be in the wilderness. He had to build his own army for the Lord, starting with people who were destitute, indebted, the outcast of the kingdom. Sometimes some of us are like David. We were not the best that the world had to offer. We were not the most eloquent, the most articulate. Our speech might even be contemptible to some people. We might not have the best education of the seminaries, but we have been with Jesus like his disciples. The scribes, Pharisees, and the priests in the days of Jesus, they were the most learned people. They could recite the Bible off the tops of their heads. So they were the potential 5 talents people of God. But the prostitutes, the tax collectors, the fishermen, were not as educated in the letters. They did not memorize all the Bible. They were the one talent people, but they decided to do the will of God, and God made them 5 talents people, and took the 5 talents of the scribes, Pharisees, and priests, and gave it to them. Jesus told those Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes, and priests, "You are those who justify yourselves before men. But God knows your hearts, for that which is highly esteemed among men is an abomination in the sight of God. The law and the prophets were until John the Baptist. Since that time the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presses into it. And it is easier for heaven and earth to pass than one tittle of the law to fail." Luke 16:15-17. "But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, neither suffer you them that are entering to go in." Matthew 23:13. "Verily I say unto you, that the publicans or tax collectors and the harlots go into the kingdom of God before you. For John came unto you in the way of righteousness, and you believed him not. But the publicans or tax collectors and the harlots believed him. And you, when you had seen it, repented not afterward that you might believe him." Matthew 21:31-32. No matter what our background has been, and after the flesh people think we are a one-talent person, it does not matter. Let us learn what God expects from us, since we are anointed kings. Let us study the perfect redemption plan of God and the application of the perfect redemption plan of God. As we become doers of them and what is written in the Bible, God will entrust us with more talents. Sometimes, when you see people great in the kingdom of God, it is not because they were the best in the kingdom, but because they learned to stay when everyone else was scattered. When the teaching of Jesus became tough, many of the disciples of Jesus stopped following Jesus. Then Jesus said to the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Then Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and have known that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." John 6:67-69. So the 12 that stayed with Jesus see how God used them mightily after his death, burial, and resurrection, because God could trust them with more, for they had been with him when everybody else was scattered from Jesus. Paul says, "If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. If we do not believe him, yet he remains faithful, he cannot deny himself." 2 Timothy 2:12-13. People want only to reign with Christ or to come when the job is finished and share in the glory like the Ephraimites in Judges 8 and Judges 12. They did not fight with Gideon or with Jephthah. They did not come when they called them to come fight. But now that God has given us the victory, they want to come and take all the glory without even suffering with us. Peter also denied Jesus 3 times, but he repented, and Jesus forgave him. If we have been like Peter and denied Jesus, there is room for repentance. For unto you it is given on behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. Philippians 1:29. Chapter 6. God has a specific promise for you. 1 Samuel 9:26-27. And they arose early. And it happened about the spring of the day that Samuel called Saul to the top of the house, saying, "Up, so that I may send you away." And Saul arose, and both of them went out, he and Samuel outside. They were going down to the end of the city, and Samuel said to Saul, "Tell the servant to pass on before us, and pass on, and you stand a while, so that I may cause you to hear the word of God." 1 Samuel 10:1. And Samuel took a vial of oil and poured it on his head and kissed him and said, "Is it not because Jehovah has anointed you for a leader over his inheritance?" When we are anointed king and priest, the moment we are born again, there are general promises that apply to all born-again Christians. Please let us learn and meditate on what has been succinctly written on the perfect redemption plan of God and the application of the perfect redemption plan of God. All the succinct Bible studies that I write are the promises that God has given to all born-again Christians. As we read them and as we read our Bible, God will give us a specific promise concerning our family, our marriage, our children, our professions, our investments, our disciples, our house group, our church, our business, our studies, etc. Samuel told Saul to send his servant ahead so that he would tell him something. God will speak to you promises concerning your life. Share them with very few people because people will fight you for some of the promises of God in your life. See how Joseph suffered because he shared his dream with his envious brothers. When God gives you an invention or business idea, do not share it with people who are your competitors. They will steal the idea from you or the invention from you. Whenever you read the Bible or these Bible studies, pray that God will speak specifically to you. When people call me, they tell me they have read the Bible study and I was saying something that ministered to them, but I know I did not say it in the Bible study, but as they were reading that Bible study, God spoke to them and gave them a specific promise. May God bless you and keep you and stir up your heart to become a doer of His words. To God be the glory, the honor, the power, God forevermore. Amen. Regards, G.